yesterday's lecture we discussed what is meant by convergence of a sequence in a metric space, and also another concept of what is meant by a Cauchy sequence in a metric space. And we also discuss a few things about these spaces. Let us say the space RK, okay. And in this space we said that if we take a sequence xn and let us say vector x in RK, then xn converges to x if and only if xnz converges to xj for each j equal to 1 to n, okay. And also if xn is Cauchy, if and only if each xnj is Cauchy. For all z equal to 1 to n, okay. So any sequence in RK will give rise to k sequences of real numbers, and if the original sequence is a convergent sequence, each of those k z goes from 1 to k actually, okay. Each of those k sequences are convergent, and similarly if the given sequence is Cauchy, each of those k sequences are also Cauchy, okay. Then when it comes to L1, okay, let us again recall L1 was this space. It is the set of all sequences x from n to r satisfying that sigma mod xj is convergent, okay. Now in this case what will happen is that if you take some sequence xn in x, sorry, xn in this L1, then this will lead to infinitely many sequences of real number for each, because there are infinitely many for each j, j belongs to n, there will be one sequence of real numbers, okay. So xnj is a sequence of sequence in R. Now here what happens is that we can say that if xn, let us say, suppose we take some x in L1, and suppose xn, or let us say just this, xn converges to x in L1, then this will imply that xnj converges to xj in R, okay. And this is easy to prove, okay. This is easy to prove because if you look at the distance between xnj, that is what we know is that mod of xnj minus xj, this is certainly less than or equal to sigma j going from 1 to infinity, or let us say sigma k going from 1 to infinity mod xn k minus xk, and this is what we have called norm suffix 1 of xn minus x, okay. So if this is small, so for example if this is less than epsilon, this will also be less than epsilon, and that is clear. So what we can say is that xn converges to x in L1, that implies xnj converges to xj in R for each j in n, okay, okay. But in this case the converse is false, okay. In this case the converse is false. It can happen that xnj converges to xj for each j, but xn may not converge to x in L1, okay. And as you know, to show that anything is false, there is only one way, we need to give a counterexample. And to give a counter example, let us take this sequence En, okay. This is a very well known sequence En. What is En? En is the sequence whose nth term is 1 and all other terms are 0, okay. So for example, E1 is this sequence, E1 is 1 0 0 etc, E2 is 0 1 etc, okay. That is En, okay. Now in this case, for example, if you look at En of j, look at the sequence En, for example, suppose you take En of 1, okay. What is that sequence? En of 1 is 1 0 0 0 etc, right, okay. What is En of 2? It is 0 1 0, 0, etc. Okay. So, in general, suppose you take any En of j, okay, any En of j, it will be 0, 0, jth term will be 1 and it will be again 0, 0, 0. Okay. So, is it clear that En of j tends to 0 for each j in n? Okay. En of j tends to 0 for each j in n. Okay. Now the question is, does En tend to 0? Okay. Okay. Does En tend to 0? Okay. This is the question. Does En tends to 0 in L1? What is the meaning of saying En tends to 0? 0 means the sequence 0, 0, 0, okay, constant sequence 0, 0, 0. Okay. Now to do that, we will have to look at distance between En and 0. Okay. Look at distance between En and 0. Okay. That is distance between En and 0, and that is nothing but norm of En. Okay. There is nothing but norm suffix En of it. And what is that? A summation of, okay. And so what is that? What is the value? For example, what is norm of E1? Okay. So norm of any En is 1, right? Norm of any En is 1. So that is equal to 1 for every n, right? Okay. So can that converge to 0? For every n, distance between En and 0 is 1. So certainly En cannot converge to 0 in L1, even though Enj converges to 0 for all j. Okay. So in spaces like L1, Lp, etc., etc., we have to be a little more careful. Okay. This, though x, whenever xn converges to x in L1, xnj converges to xj in R, that is true, but the converse is not true. Okay. And similar thing can be said about the Cauchy sequences. Okay. If xn is a Cauchy sequence, we can say that each xnj is a Cauchy sequence, okay, but again the converse is false. Okay. Again you can take the same example, okay, right. Okay. Now we should also relate to this concept of the convergence of a sequence and the concept of a closure that we have seen earlier. Okay. So to do that, let us again take a general metric space. Xd is a metric space. And suppose A is a subset of X. Okay. Then what we want to say is that if you take any sequence of elements in A, okay, if you take any sequence of elements in A, and suppose that sequence converges to some element, not necessarily in A, some element in X, then that limit must be in A closure. Okay. Then that limit must be in A closure. Conversely, if you take any element in A closure, it must be a limit of some sequence of elements in A. Okay, right. So what we want to say is that suppose A is a subset of X, and suppose you take X as any point of X. Okay, then okay, X belongs to A closure. X belongs to A closure if and only there exists a sequence, let us say, suppose I call it sequence An. So there is a sequence An of elements in A. There exists a sequence An of, this is important, okay, that all elements are in A, that is important, okay. Sequence of elements in A converging to X. Okay, so you can call this as a theorem. Okay, so this expresses the points in the closure of a set as limits of sequences of elements in the given set. Okay. Now to look at the proof, now let us look at this way first. Okay, suppose there exists a sequence of elements, okay, An in A, such that An converges to X. Okay. Now to show that X is in the A closure, what is it that we want to show? Yeah, you take any open ball with center at X, okay, and show that open ball with center at X, its intersection with A is non-empty, right. So let us take an open ball with, let us say, center at X and radius epsilon. Okay. Okay. So consider U X epsilon. Consider U X epsilon, okay, all right. Now, what we know is that this sequence a n converges to x, okay. So, for this epsilon, there will exist some n 0, there will exist some n 0, such that whenever n is bigger than or equal to n 0, all those n's are in this, okay. So, look, let us consider for some epsilon bigger than 0, then there exists n 0 in n, such that n bigger than or equal to n 0, that implies a n belongs to u x epsilon, okay. And a n is in A and it is in u x. So, we have shown that if you take any open ball with center at x, its intersection with A is non empty, okay, right. So, that shows that x belongs to A closure, okay, right. So, that shows that x belongs to A closure. Now let us look at the other way, that is suppose x belongs to A closure, okay, then we want to show that there exists a sequence of elements in A converging to x, okay, converging to x, okay. All right, again let us look at if x belongs to A closure means what, if you take any r positive, then open ball with center at x and radius r, that should contain a point from A, okay. So, I will take r as 1 by n, okay, I will take r as 1 by n. So, what you can say is that open ball with center at x at radius 1 by n, for every n in open ball with center at x at radius 1 by n, its intersection with A must be non empty, okay. So, take some point in this and I will call that point a n, okay. So, let us say that let a n belong to this u x 1 by n intersection A, okay. Then a n is a sequence in A, right, okay. Then a n is a sequence in A because it each a n belongs to A, okay. Each a n belongs to A. So, then a n is a sequence in A. In A. So, what remains to be shown? That A n converges to x, okay. What remains to be shown? That A n converges to x, okay. But is it clear? What can we say about the distance between A n and x? Since A n belongs to u x 1 by n, we know that distance between A n and x is strictly less than 1 by n, okay, and for all n. And this is always a non-negative number, it is a distance, okay. So, we can say 0 less than or equal to this and this is less than 1 by n for all n, okay. And so, we know this goes to 0 as n goes to infinity. So, this also must go to 0 as the so called sandwich theorem, okay. So, this also must go to 0 as. So, this means distance between a n and x, that is this implies that distance between a n and x tends to 0, okay, which is same as saying that a n converges to x. Is this clear? Now that we are at the points of discussing some properties of the closure, let me also introduce a couple of terms that we shall require very often, okay. We say that suppose we take any metric space X and A as a subset of X, okay. We use this terminology, we say that A is dense in X. A is called dense in X, okay. This means A closure is equal to X, okay. A is said to be dense in X, if A closure is equal to X, okay. Let us see what is the meaning of this, okay. A closure is always going to be a subset of X, right. So, what is important is X is in A closure, okay, which means every point of the metric space is in the closure of A, okay. every point of the metric space is in the closure of A. What is the meaning of this? If every point is the closure of A, if you take any ball with the center at that point, its intersection with A must be non-empty. Okay, but if that has to be happened, that has to happen to any point. That means it must happen to any open, because every open ball is going to be open ball with some center. Okay, so we can say that we can make this small observation: A is dense in X if and only every open ball in X has a non-empty intersection with A. Okay, every open ball in X has a non-empty intersection with A. Okay, usually we simply express that by saying that every open ball in X intersects A. Okay, it intersects A means it has a non-empty intersection. Okay, that's a quite customary usage of terminology. Okay, we said every open ball in X intersects A. Okay, all right. Okay, is it also clear that if every open ball intersects A, then every non-empty open set will also intersect A? Okay, if you take any non-empty open set, it has to contain some open ball. Okay, some open ball. So that will have intersection with non-empty intersection with A. So the given open set should also have non-empty. So you can say this is if and only if every open set, not every open, because empty set is also open. So we have to exclude that. Okay, so every non-empty open set, every non-empty open set intersects A. What are the well-known examples of such sets? For example, we can take the set of all rational numbers, okay, in the real line. Okay, what is the closure of that? We have seen that it's R. Okay, so we can say that Q is dense in R. Right? Q is dense in R. Okay. And what will this statement mean? Every open ball in X intersects A means every open interval contains a rational number, right? Every open interval contains a rational number, something which we already proved. Okay, right? What about the set of all irrationals? That is also dense. Okay, that is also dense. Okay. What about set of all natural numbers? Because its closure is the it's a closed set and it's different from R. Okay, right? Okay. Now, one more definition. We say that a metric space X is separable. Okay, we said it's separable if it has a countable dense subset. Okay, right? X is said to be separable. Okay, if X has a countable dense subset. What is an obvious example of a separable metric space? You already have it. Q is dense in R. Q is countable, right? Q is countable. So R is a separable metric space. Okay, right? Okay. What about R2?
Then Q cross Q.
You can say Q cross Q is dense in R2. Q cross Q is dense and Q cross Q is countable. So that's also an example of a countable and dense subset. So it's an example of a separable metric space. Okay, all right. What is an example of a metric space which is not separable?
L1.
No, L1 is separable, but only thing is it is somewhat difficult to show that. But we shall discuss it little later. Okay. Now, okay. Let us look at this. A is dense in X means every non-empty set should intersect A, okay, right. So if you take every non-empty or every open ball in X should intersect A, okay. But suppose a matrix space contains an uncountable family of pairwise disjoint open balls, okay, right. Then is it clear that then such a matrix space cannot have a countable dense subset, okay, because every open ball has to contain, for if any set is dense in that matrix space, then every open ball has to contain at least one point from that set. So, and if that family is uncountable, that set will be automatically uncountable. So, no countable set can be dense in such a matrix space. All right. Okay. Now, suppose I take this set R, but instead of taking usual metric, suppose I give discrete metric to it. Okay. Suppose I take R D, where D is a discrete metric. D is discrete metric. Then we have seen that in discrete metrics, even the singleton X is an open. Singleton X is nothing but open ball with center at X and radius 1. Okay, okay, and R is union of this singleton X for X in R. Okay, in other words, suppose you take this. Ux1 with x in R, that is, suppose I take this set ux1 with x in R, that is an uncountable family of open balls, okay, and any two open balls in this are disjoint, any two open balls in this are disjoint, okay, right. So this cannot have any countable dense subset, okay, this cannot have any countable dense subset. So R with discrete metric is a simplest example of matrix space which is not separable. Okay, we will proceed further. We shall now go back to the theorem which we were about to prove yesterday, that is, every convergent sequence is Cauchy. Okay, every convergent sequence is Cauchy. And well, proof of this is again very similar to the proof of the corresponding theorem in about sequences of real numbers, okay. The idea is basically the same, that is, if a sequence converges to some point X, it means all the points of the sequence come very close to, arbitrarily close to that point, and hence any two points of the sequence should come close to each other, okay. That's the whole idea of this proof, okay. So suppose Xn converges to X. Xn converges to X in X, okay. Then we want to show that Xn is a Cauchy sequence, okay. So let us say that let epsilon be bigger than 0, and what we want to show is that given for this epsilon there exists some n0 such that whenever m and n both are bigger than or equal to n0, distance between Xm and Xn is less than epsilon, okay. All right, but what we know is that it's a convergent sequence. So for every epsilon, we can always find some n0 such that whenever n is bigger than or equal to n0, distance between xn and x is less than epsilon. Okay, so we can say that there exists n0 in H such that n bigger than or equal to n0. This implies distance between xn and x is less than, I can take epsilon by 2 instead of epsilon, okay, because this is true for every positive number. So instead of epsilon I can as well take epsilon by 2, which is what we had done in that proof also, okay. Then consider any n and m bigger than or equal to n0, then for n and m bigger than or equal to n0, distance between xn and xm, what is to be done is clear, okay. Use triangular equality, this is less than or equal to distance between xn and x plus distance between x and xm, and each of that is less than epsilon by 2. So okay, what you observe here is that proof is more or less similar. Okay, only thing what has happened here is that wherever there was mod xn minus xm or mod xn minus x, that kind of terms are replaced by distance between xn and x. Okay, so essentially the same idea is used here in this proof also. Okay, and now this raises a very important question right here. What about the converse? In case of real line, we had proved that the converse is also true. Okay, and we had proved that using several so many things, limit superior, limit inferior, and LUB axioms, and all those things. Okay, in a general metric space, this may not be true. Okay, in an arbitrary metric space, this may not be true. Okay, what are the obvious examples? We have seen that given any metric space, and if you take any subset of that metric space, then that itself is a metric space. Okay, with the metric induced by the original metric. Okay, so what we can say is that, for example, suppose I take, instead of taking x as a real line, suppose I take x as, let us say, 0 to 1 by, okay, or let's say 0 to 1. That is open at 0. At, of course, we can take open at both ends also, but doesn't matter. Okay, open interval, semi-open, semi-closed interval, open at 0 and closed at 1. Okay, all right. Okay. Now this is also a metric space with the usual metric coming from R. Okay, right. Now in this metric space, suppose I consider a sequence xn as 1 by n. Okay, right. We already know that this is a Cauchy sequence. 1 by n is a Cauchy sequence. Okay, 1 by n is a Cauchy sequence. Okay, okay. But is it also clear that this doesn't converge in X? Right, because what will happen is, suppose it converges to some point in X, what is the argument? Then that point must be strictly bigger than 0. Okay, but we also know that this is also a sequence in R. Okay, and in R it converges to 0. Okay, that will mean that the convergent sequence in R has two different limits. That is not possible, right? That is not possible. Okay, so that means this is a Cauchy sequence, but it has no limit in X. Okay, it has no limit in X. Okay, so in an arbitrary metric space, it is not true that every Cauchy sequence converges. Okay, all right. Okay. So those metric spaces which have this additional property, they are given some special name, but we'll come to that little later. Okay, before that, I want to also discuss one more property of the Cauchy sequences. And that is the following. Okay, let us take this also as a theorem. Every Cauchy sequence is bounded. Every Cauchy sequence is bounded. So again, a Cauchy sequence is bounded means what? Yes?
Lower bound, upper bound
exist. There is no such thing as lower bound and upper bound. It is a sequence in any arbitrary metric space. Okay, right? We can talk of lower bound or upper bound only of sequences of real numbers. Okay, when you talk of sequences in an arbitrary metric space, there will be no order. Okay, but we have defined what is meant by a bounded set in a metric space. What is that? Its diameter is finite. Okay, for any set, we say that it is a bounded if its diameter is finite. Okay, what is meant by a sequence is bounded? You take the set when will we say that a function is bounded? Its a range is bounded. Its range is bounded. So sequence is a function. Okay, so saying that sequence is bounded, it's same as saying that. Its range of that, what is the range of the sequence? It is a set of all points which make that sequence. Okay, we have to show that is bounded. Okay, right. So what is the meaning of this? To suppose xn is a Cauchy sequence, let xn be a Cauchy sequence in X. Then we want to show that xn is bounded. Okay, now in view of all this discussion, what it means that if you take any two points of the sequence xn and xm, distance between, take distance between xn and xm, okay, distance between xn and xm, then that should be bounded above regardless of what n and m you take, that should be bounded above, okay, because the diameter of this will be supremum of xn and xm where n and m both vary, okay, that is what we should show, okay. Okay, let me just write what is it, what is to be shown, to show this there exists some real number alpha bigger than 0 such that distance between, suppose I take any two points here, distance between let us say xi and xj, this is less than or equal to alpha for all I and j. That is the meaning, right? That is the meaning. Okay, now what is the obvious way of proceeding with this? We have to make use of the fact that it is a Cauchy sequence, okay, we have to make use of the fact that it is a Cauchy sequence. Let us make use, let us, what is the use of a Cauchy sequence? If you are given any epsilon bigger than 0, there exists h0 etc, okay, let us start with that, okay. So let us take any arbitrary epsilon, so let epsilon bigger than 0, then there exists n0 in n such that n and m, for all n and m bigger than or equal to n0, this implies distance between xm and xn is less than epsilon. Okay, what is it that we want to show? If you take any I and j, there exists some alpha such that if you take any I and j, distance between xi and xj is less than or equal to alpha, okay. What we already got here, that if this I and j, if both of them are bigger than or equal to n0, then this number is less than or equal to epsilon, okay. All right, now what is left now? Yeah, if those I and j which are less than or equal to n0, okay, those I and j which are less than, but how many such pairs will be there, okay? Yeah, there will be only finite, okay, it does not matter actually how many it will be, there is a finite number, okay. So consider this set, okay, consider distance between xi and xj where 1 less than or equal to I, less than or equal, or okay, less than, fine, less than n0, and 1 less than or equal to j, less than n0, okay. This is a finite set, okay, this is a finite set, okay, right. So since it is a finite set, we can take maximum of this, okay, we can easily find some number which is bigger than or equal to all these numbers, okay. Suppose I call that number beta, okay, this is a finite set, okay. So let us say, suppose I call that number beta, let beta be equal to maximum of distance between xi and xj, 1 less than or equal to I, less than n0, and 1 less than or equal to j, less than n0, okay. Alright, okay. So now what is the situation? We know that if I and j both are bigger than or equal to n0, then distance between xi and xj is less than epsilon, okay. Alright, if I and j both are less than or equal to n0 or less than n0, then the distance between xi and xj is less than beta, less than or equal to beta. So what is left now?
Epsilon.
Yes?
Maximum of beta and epsilon. Maximum of beta and epsilon.
Maximum of beta and epsilon, okay. And why do you say that if the distance between xi and xj should be less than or equal to maximum of beta and epsilon in all such cases?
Because if it is a monotonically increasing sequence, then all term would be less than, and the large supremum would be the maximum one, na, in that case.
But this is not given to be monotonically increasing sequence, okay. See, again look at this, what are the cases we have disposed of already? If I and j both are bigger than or equal to n0, okay, and if I and j both are less than n0, what is the case left? Equal to is included here. okay, equality is included here. See, can it not happen that one of them is less than n0 and other is bigger than n0, right? It can happen that one of them, for example, it can happen that I is less than n0 but j is bigger than or equal to n0, okay. That is not covered by any of this, right? That is not covered by any of this, okay, right? Okay, in fact here for to take into account that case, let me first take this equal to here, okay, this equal to here, okay, right? And so now let us say, suppose one of them is less than, like, suppose, and for one less than or equal to I less than or equal to n0, and say j bigger than or equal to n0, j bigger than or equal to n0, okay. Then what can we say about distance between xi and xj? What we can do is that use the again the usual triangular inequality, okay. We can say distance between xi and xj, this is less than or equal to distance between xi and xn0, okay, plus distance between xn0 and xj, okay. Now this is less than beta or less than or equal to beta, and this is less than epsilon, okay. So the whole thing is less than beta plus epsilon, okay, okay, okay. So now is it clear to you that whatever I at j you take, distance between xi and xj will always be less than beta plus epsilon, okay, okay. If both are less than or equal to n0, if I and j both are less than or equal to n0, distance is less than beta, less than or equal to beta. If all of them if both of them are bigger than or equal to n0, the distance is less than epsilon, and if one is less than or equal to n0, other is bigger than or equal to n0, it is less than beta plus epsilon, okay. So that means you just take alpha equal to, take alpha is equal to beta plus epsilon, and this will be true, okay. Distance between xi and xj is less than or equal to alpha for all I and j, okay. Maximum of beta and epsilon will not work. Maximum of beta and epsilon will not work. It is because it doesn't cover this case. Okay. Okay. Of course, we know that the converse of this is false. Okay, there can exist a bounded sequence which is not Cauchy. Okay. Right? We have seen an example of that kind in real numbers. It is okay. The standard sequence 1 minus 1, 1 minus 1. It's a bounded sequence, but it is not Cauchy. Okay, it is not Cauchy. Does it follow from here that every convergent sequence is bounded? Okay, we have shown that every convergent sequence is Cauchy, and now we show that every Cauchy sequence is bounded. So we can say as a corollary, every convergent sequence is bounded. Convergent sequence is bounded. In all these proofs, as I said earlier, you would have seen that we have imitated the proofs of the corresponding theorems about the sequences of real numbers, okay, okay. But of course, while imitating those proofs, we have to take care not to use those properties which are peculiar to real numbers, okay. For example, things like upper bound, lower bounds, or things like monotonically increasing sequences or decreasing sequences, those are the properties which are peculiar to real numbers, okay. And those are not properties shared by arbitrary metric spaces, because in an arbitrary metric space there may not be any order, okay. All right. Okay, now before proceeding further, let me give you a couple of exercises here, and that is about the subsequences, okay. So suppose let us say that let xd be a metric space, and let us say that xn be a sequence in x, okay. Then show that one, if xn converges to x, that is if xn is a convergent sequence converging to x, then every subsequence of xn also converges to s. Every subsequence of xn also converges to x. Okay. And the second property is that if xn is a Cauchy sequence, okay, and if it has a convergent sequence, then the original sequence itself converges. Okay. That is, if xn is a Cauchy sequence, and it has a convergent subsequence, then xn itself is a convergent sequence. Okay. Then xn converges. Now let us again come back to this, our discussion of relationship between convergent sequences and Cauchy sequences. We have seen that every convergent sequence is Cauchy, but in an arbitrary matrix space the converse is false. Okay. So those matrix spaces in which the converse is true, that is in those matrix spaces in which every Cauchy sequence is convergent, those are given special names. Those matrix spaces are called complete matrix spaces. Okay. And completeness is a very important property of a matrix space may or may not have. Okay, so let us start with this definition. A matrix space XD is said to be complete if every Cauchy sequence in X converges to some point in X. Of course, it should have been enough to simply say that every Cauchy sequence in X converges. Okay, converges means converges to some point in X is understood. But this last words are written just to make it clear, because in this case, Cauchy sequence 1 by n is a Cauchy sequence in X, but it does not converge in X. Okay, it converges to some point which is outside X. That is not what is intended here. Okay, it should converge to some point in X. Okay, then before proceeding further, let me also make one comment about couple of points which sometimes create confusion in the minds of the students. Okay, there are two concepts which we have seen while looking at the sequences. One is a limit of a sequence, and other is limit point. Okay, and quite frequently it is found that there is a confusion about these two concepts. Okay, you should be very clear that these two are totally different concepts. Okay, right, we talk of limit of a sequence, okay, and we talk of limit point of a set. Okay, right, we talk of limit of a sequence and we talk of limit point of a set. Okay, of course we can talk of limit point of a set which forms the sequence, that is we can talk of limit point of the range of the sequence. Okay, but that is not the same. Okay, a sequence may or may not have a limit. A sequence may or may not have a limit point. Okay, these two things are quite different. It may have a limit, it may not have a limit point, and vice versa. Okay, we can take examples of all sorts. Okay, for example, let us take the sequence this 1 -1, 1 -1, etcetera, etcetera. Okay, this has neither limit, and it doesn't have a limit point also. Okay, because its range contains only 2 points. Okay, its range contains only 2 points, 1 and -1, so it will not have any limit point. Okay. On the other hand, suppose you take the constant sequence 1, 1, 1, etc. Okay, then it has a limit. Okay, then it has a limit, but it doesn't have any limit point, right? Because what is the definition of a limit point? If you take any open set containing 1, it should contain a point which is different from 1. Okay, that is not the case here. Okay, that is not the case here. So it has a limit, but it doesn't have a limit point. Okay, if you take the sequence 1 by n, then this has both limit as well as a limit point. 1 by n to 0, 0 is a limit of 1 by n, it is also a limit point of the set 1 by n, okay, right. Okay. Now coming back to this definition of a complete matrix space, as I said earlier, completeness is a very important property that a matrix space may or may not have, and those matrix spaces which are complete are quite useful in practice. We can say several things about the convergence of various sequences, and those are quite useful in various approximation schemes, etc. Okay, those things we shall see little later, but to begin with, let us first see among the various examples that we have seen about the matrix spaces, which ones are complete and which ones are not complete. Okay, first of all, okay, let us start with a discrete matrix space. Let X be any non-empty set and D is a discrete matrix space. Now we have seen that what are the Cauchy sequences in discrete matrix space? We have seen that in a discrete matrix space,
constant sequence.
Yeah, if a sequence is Cauchy, it must become constant after some stage. Okay, so sequence is Cauchy if and only if it is eventually constant. Okay, now will such a sequence always be convergent? Right, because if it anyway it is becoming constant eventually, so it will be a convergent sequence. Okay, so discrete matrix is always a complete matrix space. Okay. So this is complete. Okay. Okay. Then R is an example of a complete matrix space. Okay. Right. R is an, because that is what we have proved elaborately, that in R every Cauchy sequence converges. Right. Okay. This is an example of a matrix space which is not complete. This is an example of a matrix space which is not complete. Of course, here I can make a small comment, that is, this is not complete because the point 0 is not there. Okay, suppose you add the point 0 to this and then the new space will be this 0 1, then this will be a complete matrix space. Okay, right, then this will be a complete matrix space. Okay, and usually such a thing can be done, that is, given any matrix space, if required you can extend that space to a slightly bigger space to make it complete. That is possible in case of all matrix spaces, and such a thing is called a completion. Okay, completion of a matrix space. Okay, so we shall not right now discuss this concept of how does one complete a given matrix space, etc. Okay, but that is something a different topic altogether that we might see after some time. Okay. Now coming back to the examples, it's clear that R is complete. The next set, for example, also let us also look at C. Okay. Look at C. Okay, in C, the idea is simply this: that is, suppose you take a Cauchy sequence. Suppose Zn is equal to Xn plus I times Yn. Okay, suppose this is a Cauchy sequence. Then what we show is that Xn and Yn are also Cauchy sequences. Okay. Xn and Yn are also Cauchy sequences, and we use the same thing. That is, Zn minus Zm will be Xn minus Xm plus I times Yn minus Ym. So mod xn minus xm will be less than or equal to mod zn minus zm, and similarly for mod yn minus ym. Okay, and so xn and yn both are Cauchy sequences. So so since they are Cauchy sequences of real numbers, and we know that R is complete, so xn converges to x, yn converges to y, then we can show that zn converges to x plus iy. Okay, so this will be a proof to show that every Cauchy sequence in C also converges. Okay, so R and C both are again the examples of complete matrix spaces. Okay, and whatever proof I have said here, essentially the same proof will work for R2. Okay, R2 or for that matter any of the R case. Okay, right. So let us again recall here, that is, in suppose we take RK. Okay, we have seen that in case of RK, if you take any sequence Xn, it leads to this K sequences Xnz. For each j equal to 1 to k, okay, right? And so what we have seen here is that if this xn is a Cauchy sequence, each of these xnj is also a Cauchy sequence, okay, and it is a Cauchy sequence of real numbers, and we already know that R is complete. So each of these sequence converges, okay. So xnj converges to some, let us say xj, okay, okay. So there are j such real numbers, x1, x2, etc. Sorry, there are k such real numbers, x1, x2, xk. So that will be an element of Rk, okay, and then this xn will converge to that particular x, okay. So each of this Rk is complete, okay. Similarly, each of this Ck is also complete. Now the next important types of spaces in which we need to discuss the completeness are the spaces like L1 and LP, L infinity, etc. Okay, and the spaces of functions. Okay. As we have seen just in the beginning of this class, this kind of argument will not work immediately for the spaces like L1 and LP. It will need some extra work. But it is true that all of these LP spaces are complete. We shall just see how that can be proved. Okay. And then we'll talk about the function spaces. Okay. All right, we shall do this in the next class.